Benefits from being actively interested, engaged in your learning. Technology is a tool which helps mediate that relationship between your student learning and engagement. So how many of you have ever heard the term virtual reality? I'm sure most of you have. So a very quick definition of virtual reality, because you're seeing it all over the news nowadays. A lot of kids are acquiring the virtual reality with their cell phones and a set of goggles, which I will show you here tonight. So essentially, it's a computer-generated 3D image or environment which can be interacted with in a seemingly real or physical way. And some of the benefits of using virtual reality in a learning environment is that it promotes that active learning, those engaging activities, making those memorable learning moments, all of those pieces that we know help promote that positive impact to educational outcomes because you're engaging students in that learning process. So Google has an app that they created, and it is called Expeditions. And as the name implies, they are expeditions or trips, journeys that you can take virtually to almost anywhere, not only to places, but to see things that you might never in your life get an opportunity to see. And last spring at the district, and those of you on the tech committee might recall, we actually applied to Google because at that point in time they hadn't released the app publicly. We applied to Google to be a part of a pilot program to get the beta version of the app, and we were selected and we did receive that. That was the software end of things. So then this past year, through the help of the Greater Latrobe Partners in Education Foundation, we were actually able to buy the hardware pieces that actually work through the app, and those are called the Google Expedition Kits. And what the Google Expedition Kits are made up of is they're made up of a teacher tablet, phones, which are phones except they don't have a phone service. They just look like a phone and they can hold apps like a phone. And these goggles that you can use. So the way the app works is the teacher's tablet acts as the guide or the lead explorer. And you choose the expedition or journey that you want to take your students on. And when you do that, you can then broadcast it out across the app on the phone, which is then placed inside the goggles, giving you the 3D virtual reality experience. So in a classroom environment, this can be a great, engaging teaching tool for students. Currently, there are over 200 expeditions that are available through the app. They range anywhere from historical places, natural wonders, landmarks, science topics such as the human body, the lungs, how the heart works, the International Space Station, earthquakes, museums, colleges, universities. You can actually look at Beaver Stadium up at Penn State through the Expedition app. There are even career expeditions. If you want to see what life is like in the day of an airline pilot, or a veterinarian, civil engineer, restaurant owner, you can see those as well. So there really is no grade level or subject area that I don't feel can be touched by these kits. Each of the kits serves up to 30 students. We were able to purchase two of them. We'll be placing one at the elementary level and one at the secondary level. So, with all of those choices on the expeditions, I had to come down to one to take you guys on. And as Judy can probably tell you, I struggled with it. I was going back and forth. There were so many different things I wanted to show you. But I ended up choosing, and this was the vote by the admin team after we had looked at a few, was how many of you are familiar with Shark Week on Discovery Ed? Okay, so we're going to look at some sharks, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about sharks. Now, one other thing I want to tell you before we begin is in a teaching environment, if you were using these as a teacher, there would be a pre-activity to the expedition in which you would talk about what your expedition is going to be about, give your students some knowledge base, maybe ask some big questions of them, and then you would do the expedition, and then you would follow up with some post-expedition activities. For the sake of time, we're just going to go right to the expedition and do fun stuff tonight. We can skip the pre and the post. The other thing I want to mention to you is there is no movement in the image. The movement is generated by you. So when you look in the goggles, you can do a 360 degree turn to see the image from all angles. As the teacher or the lead, I can direct you to certain areas by pointing. So if you see an arrow, you want to follow the arrow and then there will be a circle. That's something in particular that I'm going to talk about, called a talking point. So as we go through, I'll let you look at them and kind of get a little bit acclimated. You can stay in your seat. Just be careful when you're turning. If you stand up, just be careful. Maybe we don't want to stand up. But you need to go 360 if you want to. But if you can possibly reach most of the way by going around. So we are going to visit a couple different places tonight. Fiji being the first one, looking at some bull sharks. And then we're also going to visit Mexico and look at a whale shark. So Rena's going to pass out everybody's goggles. All you have to do is just pick them up. And you got some help with writing them.
Right? Want to try it?
Thank you.
Go ahead, turn it on. What do you got on there, Rob? Well, I'm just gonna show them, if you can see on my screen, see all the little smiley faces?
I don't see what I show.
I mean, that's all that. Okay, I'm gonna start first. Now these expeditions all come with teaching tools, information that you now, there's actually lesson plans teachers can use. You obviously can use as much or as little as you want from them, but I'm just gonna read some of the brief points from this, just so you get an idea of some of the teaching that's involved. This one's titled Bull Sharks. Welcome to Fiji, a country in the South Pacific with a rugged landscape of blue lagoons and palm-lined beaches. Although it seems like a serene setting, this tropical oasis is home to one of the best shark dives in the world, featuring one of the most feared sharks of all time, the bull shark. I'm going to show you the bull shark. I'm pointing to the bull shark, and you follow my arrow, and you find the circle. Ah, yes, you're all there. Bull sharks are thought to be the most dangerous species of sharks because they are common, aggressive, live near populated tropical shorelines, and also frequently travel far inland of freshwater rivers. Here's another one. If you want to move to that circle, talk about shark diversity. There are more than 440 species of shark that have been recorded around the world. They come in all shapes and sizes and can be found everywhere from Fiji to Florida. Okay, that's one scene. We're going to move on to another scene, so get ready. Your screen's going to change. This one's called the whale shark. We head over to Mexico, known for its beaches and water-based activities for our next dive in sharks. Here we get to meet the biggest fish in the ocean, the whale shark, a rare species thought to migrate extremely long distances. Okay, follow the arrow. There's the whale shark. You see under the shark's fin, those are called hitchhikers. Small fish often hitch a ride alongside whale sharks. Although it may seem counterintuitive, the fish aren't in any real danger since whale sharks mostly feed on plankton. In Mexico, manta rays like to keep company with the sharks too. Ready? We'll move on to the great white. A cave dive with a hungry great white shark is a bucket list item that many may never experience. We've come to the cold waters of Port Lincoln in South Australia to meet this ocean giant in its natural habitat behind the safety of steel bars. Now, can you all find the great white shark? I'm going to point it out so I see you go to it. Okay, there we go. Oh. Let's take a look at the reef sharks.
They're all on the pocket.
is an area off the coast of Australia that has not been heavily fished due to its remote location. As a result, it is one of the best locations in the world to encounter healthy populations of reef sharks, including the black-tipped reef shark. There's the black-tipped reef shark.
Be careful there.
George and I bumped into each other today. You lose where you're at.
They always seem to be behind.
That's a remora fish. Remora fish attach themselves to sharks with a suction disc on the top of their head. The remoras feed on parasites found on the shark's skin, which in turn benefits the shark by keeping it clean and healthy. This one's shark encounters. One of the easiest places to encounter a shark in the wild is Sydney, where they can usually be found resting on the ocean floor or sheltering under rocky ledges. There are over 60 recorded species of shark in the waters around this major city. Here's a Port Jackson shark. This Port Jackson shark is abundant in Sydney. It definitely isn't the scariest shark around, since they usually don't grow larger than a meter and don't have sharp, pointy teeth. Okay, we'll go on to gray nurse sharks. One of the easiest places to encounter a shark in the wild is Sydney. Oh, that's actually the same as I gave before. There are over 60 recorded species of shark in the waters around this major city, including the gray nurse shark, the world's most menacing yet harmless shark. Can you find the gray nurse shark? Mm-hmm. And although the gray nurse sharks are rather large and have rows and rows of razor sharp teeth, they're not considered dangerous to humans. They're rather docile. They breed in the waters close to Sydney and provide a thrill to scuba divers. Okay, here's the last one. This is our white-tipped reef sharks. Okay, I'm really going to butcher this today. I'm just going to go for it. Chubataha in the Philippines was only discovered by scuba divers as recently as in 1970. Because of its remote location, there are fewer fishermen and the fish life is abundant. As a result, with 14 species of sharks to be found. Here's the white-tipped reef shark. In this image, you can see some white-tipped reef sharks cruising along the reef looking for prey. This species of shark is timid and not a danger to humans, but they are curious and likely to investigate scuba divers. And we're going to point to some healthy coral. You can find that. The healthy coral reef here means that there are plenty of small reef fish to be found, which in turn attracts bigger fish and sharks, leading to a balanced ecosystem. That concludes our expedition, unless Judy wants to forego the rest of the board meeting, I need to show you. So as I mentioned, we were able to, with the help of the foundation, get two complete kits, which is 30 students each, complete with a teacher tablet, all the goggles, and the phone devices for the students. We're going to be housing one in the elementary level, one in the secondary level, starting professional development with the librarians, and then moving on to teacher leaders in hopes that teachers can start incorporating this into their classes and using this, which is a great teacher. Any questions from anyone? There really isn't any technology in the goggle itself. It's really just the lens and holding the phone close up to your face. It's really in the app is the way it displays the image that creates the 3D effect. reading glasses that have motion with them.
Oh, no.
But the power in the app with Google Expeditions is the ability that I have as a teacher to push that with on my screen to 30 devices and to guide my students through a learning experience. And that's the power of the Google Expeditions.
Please thank the foundation.
Yes, absolutely. Definitely will. Thank you.
Any questions, Rob?
Just let any of you kids fear.
These are really sturdy communities, right? Because I'm thinking, one, for the elementary level, we've got three schools, hundreds of kids.
Yeah.
And once the first staff has it, everybody is going to want it.
Yeah, I agree, but we have to start somewhere. And just getting them into the buildings and getting professional development on them and getting them exposed, we were able to start working it in, and then obviously the plan would be to acquire more. But this is at least a starting point to get it in the hands of our kids and our teachers so we can get it moving, so.
The next WIU meeting will be Tuesday, the 24th at 7 p.m. in the WIU. Thank you. Keep going. And the next curriculum committee meeting curriculum and planning will be Tuesday, February 28th, here at 5:30 p.m. in the CS.
We're going to have a presentation regarding our local audit. I'm Barbara Garrett.
Barb, Mike, can spend your takes on version 4 of our audit.
Okay, so all of you got your audits last week. I don't know if you have them on your screens or not. I could just cover the highlights.
Yes?
Okay. In your independent auditor's report, it outlines our responsibility versus your responsibility, and it provides an opinion, our opinion, as to whether we feel the financial statements are stated fairly in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. You have a clean opinion. We have an unmodified opinion, which is a clean opinion, so that's the best that you can get. The management's discussion and analysis is actually prepared by Dan, so that provides an overview of all of the financial operations for the year, so an outline of accomplishments, etc. So if you want to take a look at that, it tries to put it in layman's terms. The statement of net position is your government-wide financial statement, and it's supposed to mirror a for-profit entity. And it shows that you have a net position of a negative $24 million, which makes it look kind of bleak, but it really isn't as bleak as it looks. Your current assets exceed your current liabilities, which means you have working capital to pay your bills. That's a good thing. Your pension liability nets down to, between all of the various pieces on there, nets down to $69 million. And your post-employment benefits, which would be your post-employment health care, is $4.5 million. So your liabilities that you can do nothing about are $75 million. And so they require that those are on there so that your net position of $24 million sounds really good whenever you figure that you've got the $73 million of uncontrollable liabilities on there. But from a budget standpoint, really what you want to look at is the governmental financial statements, the fund financial statements, And those really are on pages 17 through 26. So when you look at it, that's what you're used to seeing with your budget. And we don't even report the government-wide on the state annual financial reports anymore. They require those for a couple years. They look at them in our in the audits. The audits get uploaded to the state, but they don't want all of that as the report anymore. It just doesn't do them as much good as what your financial and your fund financial statement makes you comparable to other school districts, and that's what they use for whatever they need.
Or and not on negative net positions you mentioned on the a statement of net position report on page. It can be in the negative. That's common for pretty much every district across the state of Pennsylvania. It's we're the second year of that when we were required to report that
those pension liabilities.
Pension liabilities, which really kind of made a mess of that page, and it's not just unique for the term.
That is correct. And honestly, any government at this point that has a defined benefit plan, they're all having negative net positions at this point. Whether that will turn around someday, I don't know. But it's really a complicated, drawn-out calculation. And luckily, PSERS does that for us. So that definitely helps. But it is standard in the government arena nowadays to have that negative on the government-wide financial system. Because of the defined benefit plans. On pages 65 and 66 is our independent auditor's report on internal control and compliance at the financial statement level. We did not disclose any significant deficiencies or material weaknesses, so that's a good thing. That's a clean type of opinion as well. And then on pages 67 and 68, we have the independent auditor's report on compliance with internal control and compliance at the federal financial systems level. And once again, we, based on your funding levels in each of your federal funds, and we do kind of a risk-based approach to that, and we rotate your federal funds so that at least a minimum every 3 years, the biggest programs are audited, and they're audited for compliance. And so we didn't disclose any significant deficiencies or material weaknesses in that area either. So that's a good thing. So if anyone has any questions when they go through and look at it, anybody has any questions, please call us. That's what we're here for.
Are there any questions for Bob? Hearing none, thank you. I appreciate you coming tonight for that information.
Sure. Thank you.
Not every night you get to go to Charleston.
That's right.
I'll move for adoption of resolutions number 145 and 146. The payment of bills and the treasurer's report.
Second. Moved and seconded. Any questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And pass carries.
Then I'll move for adoption of resolution number 147 to approve the Act 1 resolution, which is the attachment to your agenda. And that resolution says that we will not raise taxes above the index this year.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any comments? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And that passes unanimously.
And finally, I'll move for the adoption of resolution number 148 to approve the local audit report, which has just been explained to us.
Second. Any comments? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And that passes.
And the next finance committee will be Wednesday, February 1st at 10 in the administration building.
Thank you. Mrs. Eller, slowly that aren't you explaining, Mr. Allen?
Yeah, I'd like to move for adoption of resolution number 149. That's F, which simply is a statement which the board will not enter into construction contracts until we receive written approval for plant on F. Board of directors have obtained or will obtain necessary approvals for local, regional, state agencies relating to health, safety, design, planning, highway access, and freedom from flooding and such prior to entering into construction contracts. The board acknowledges the failure to obtain requisite approval prior to entering into construction contracts may be sufficient cause for Department of Education to revoke its approval for this project.
Moved and seconded. Any comments or questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes.
Our next facilities operation planning committee meeting will be Thursday, February 2nd, 10 a.m. Yeah.
Student activities. I'd just like to note that the boys' basketball is changing their senior night to Monday, February 13th at 7, and that we've added hockey's, which is Thursday, February 2nd. Any relations, Dr. Coach?
Park and Rec meeting is January 19th, 4:30, from the Sherry Municipal Planning Agreement. That's all.
EWCTC, excuse me?
The next EWCTC, joint operating committee, next Wednesday, February 25th, and the EWCTC building itself.
Thank you. I'll move for adoption of resolution number 150 to approve the four board policies listed below.
Second. Moved and seconded. Any questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes unanimously.
I ask the board to move on resolution number 151, which is the approval of the resignation list.
So moved.
Second. You moved and seconded. Any questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes unanimously.
I ask the board to move on resolution number 152, which is the approval of the additional substitute teacher list.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any comments? All those in favor, please say aye. Aye. Opposed? That passes unanimously. I'd ask the board to move on resolution number 153, which is the approval of support personnel appointments supplemental.
Moved. Moved and seconded. Any comments or questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
I have some notes of dates. Breakfast of Champions is this Thursday, January 19th at 7:30. This Saturday, January 21st, in our Senior High School Auditorium is the Westmoreland County Music Education Association Senior High County Band Festival. I think it's 2 o'clock, yes, in our auditorium. In addition, our board meetings in February are Tuesday the 14th and Tuesday the 28th. And our next conversation with the superintendent will be Monday, February 6th, thank you, at 9:30 a.m. here in the center. And our guest speaker next month will be Ted Hoover from the Prasad Center. He has done some training with our teachers and is working with suicide curriculum programs this month. Cindy, I don't know if you want to add anything.
His topic is about the LGBTQ community, which is a very vulnerable population in our schools in terms of how they feel they fit in with the other student, the rest of the student body. So we're hoping to have a good evening.
Yeah. He's a great presenter.
Excellent.
We've worked with him over a year now, so hopefully get the word out so we can get some parents and community members here to hear this. Again, that's February 6th.
Now I have hearing visitors part two. This is where anybody can come to the podium, state your name, address, any concerns. Yeah, for the adoption of resolution 151. Board of Procurement.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.